Today we have the privilege of stopping for a few minutes to remember the courage and commitment of those who gave so much in two world wars and in other conflicts for our freedom. And the cost was enormous. When you look at the casualty figures from the world wars, many, many millions of men and women who died that we would know freedom. Every year I try to find a slightly different way to bring it home to us. This year I found a little video on YouTube, and it's about Bonnie Wood Green. It's a little song, folk song, that was written at the time of the First World War about one particular young lad who went to serve in the forces from Wood Green. And sadly, he paid the ultimate price and didn't come home. So let's just spend a few moments watching this video, and at the close of it, I'll ask us to stand in silence to remember the fallen.
In amongst the green bushes of Bunny Wood Green, where me and my true love so oft times have been, it was there that we sat, and so happy were we. But little she thought that a soldier I'd be. It was early next morning, as the lambs they did play. It was off to Kells barracks I there made my way. It was there I enlisted to fight for my king, for a cause to uphold I left Bonnie Wood Green. In Larne, where the troop ships sat ready to sail, and mothers were weeping as sisters looked pale, we were singing and dancing, but fathers looked sad. They were saying goodbye to their brave soldier lad. In Flanders, in a field at the back of the line, they were talking of sweethearts that all left behind. Said one Ulster soldier, sure I have a queen, and she works in John Ross's of Honeywood Green. It was early next morning, while facing the foe, a shot from the enemy our hero laid low. He called for his comrades, it was a sad scene. Say goodbye to my Nelly in Bunny Wood Green. So if ever to Ulster you happen to stray, there's a neat little factory near Ballymacbeth, where weavers and winders are there to be seen, beside the Kells water in Bunny Wood Green.
Now let us stand, bow our heads in silence, as we remember those who gave so much for our freedom. We remember those who lost their lives during the two world wars and who belong to this congregation. From the First World War, John Agnew, Samuel Caldwell, Robert Cooper, David Couples, Hugh Fisher, William McKee, William McLean, Alexander Mayers, Samuel Mahwinney, Samuel Swan, John Thompson, John Allen. From the Second World War, John Allen, Thompson Allen, George Angus, Hugh Fullerton, William McKee, James Stewart. They shall grow not old as we who are left grow old. Age shall not weary them or the years condemn. At the going down of the sun and in the morning, we will remember them. Lord God Almighty, we come before you to thank you for the dedication to duty and for the courage and sacrifice of earlier generations who gave so much for our freedom in two world wars, in other conflicts, and in the troubles in our own land. We want to say thank you for them, Lord. We thank you too for those who served and survived. We know that many of them carry in their minds and in their bodies the scars of the things they saw, heard, and experienced. Be with all such today. May they know your touch and your love, and may they know that we truly appreciate all that they have done for us. We remember those who lost loved ones in conflicts. This will be a difficult day for them, and we pray, Lord God, that your presence would really comfort them today. It's especially difficult as remembrance services up and down the land are very different. No longer any parades, no real opportunity to lay wreaths and such forth. Lord, may people realize that we still remember what their loved ones did. Even though we can't express it in the same way, we are truly appreciative of all their valor. Lord God, we pray for ourselves. We pray that we would not take for granted the freedoms that we have. Lord, these last months, some of our freedoms have been eroded because they've had to be. We're not free to do the things we used to do because of the virus. And that has taught us just how important freedom is. And it's made us appreciate all the more the cost of freedom. Lord, may we use our freedoms wisely and well, not for our own gain and our own self-promotion, but for your glory. May we use our freedoms to bring honour to you and to show your love to others, that all would know that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Boys and girls, you'll notice that I'm wearing a red poppy today, and a lot of other people will be wearing them at this time of November every year. Now, you might be asking, why do we wear poppies? I want you to watch a little short video that explains to us where the poppy came from.
The poppy. The poppy is a symbol of remembrance, worn every November to commemorate members of the armed forces who gave their lives in war. Its origins go back to the First World War. Amongst the churned up soil and shell holes of the battlefields of the Western Front, poppies would grow even when nothing else could. They would give Canadian doctor, Lieutenant Colonel John McCrae, inspiration while serving in Ypres in the spring of 1915 after recently losing his friend. He would write the now famous poem, In Flanders Fields. The poem would go on to be published in a London-based magazine called Punch. In 1918, in response to McCrae's poem, American academic Moena Michael was inspired to make and sell red silk poppies and campaigned to make the poppy a symbol of remembrance to those who had died in the war. The Royal British Legion formed in 1921 and ordered 9 million of these poppies, selling them on the 11th of November that year in support of ex-servicemen and the families of those who had died in the conflict. The poppies sold out immediately and raised a considerable amount of money. The funds went on to be used to help First World War veterans with employment and housing. Because the poppy appeal was so popular, the British Legion set up a poppy factory, employing ex-servicemen to produce them. This continues today, with the Legion producing millions of poppies each year.
There you are. The poppy reminds us of all the people who have given their lives fighting to keep us free. People in the First World War, the Second World War, other world wars, and also in the armed services in our own country, because from 1969 through to the mid-1990s, there was an awful situation where bad terrorists killed and murdered people, and the army and the police had to defend us. And they suffered many, many casualties, and we remember them today too. But the poppy doesn't just remind us of war and how much people gave for us in the war. The poppy can also tell us about the gospel. You'll notice there are three colours on the poppy. There's the black right in the middle that reminds us of the darkness of the sin that is in our hearts. Awful rebellion against God. Then there's the red of the actual outside petals of the poppy. Reminds us that Jesus Christ died on the cross and shed his blood to pay for our sin. And the green leaf at the top reminds us that when we come to Jesus and give him our hearts and our lives, then we can begin to grow and have the lives that God wants us to have in his service. So I hope you do wear a poppy at this time every year. I hope you remember how much people gave for our freedom. But I hope you remember the little gospel story that comes from the poppy as well, and that you give your life to Jesus, who gave so much for you.
Why should I fear? reading this morning is taken from Psalm 67. May God be gracious to us and bless us, and make his face to shine upon us, that your way may be known on earth, your saving power among all nations. Let the people praise you, O God, that all the people praise you. Let the nations be glad and sing for joy, for you judge the people with equity and guide the nations upon earth. Let the people praise you, O God, let all the people praise you. The earth has yielded its increase. God, our God, shall bless us. God shall bless us, let all the ends of the earth fear him. Amen.
Now, friends, we come to our intercessory prayer, and let us bow our heads and seek the Lord's face. O God, our loving Heavenly Father, we bless you that you say in your word, before you call, I will answer. And while you're yet speaking, I will hear. And we come, dear God, to remember first of all our country and those that rule over us as you've commanded us. We think of a royal family today far from God and pray, Lord, that you will deal with them and speak to them in a very definite way. We pray also for our Prime Minister. We pray for those that are over us here in Northern Ireland. We pray, O God, that you'll give them wisdoms in every decision, Father, that they make. Lord, that you'll guide them, that you'll help them. We know, Lord, that nobody can do anything right. The politicians can do nothing right. The chief medical officer can do nothing right. But thank God you're a just God and you always do what is right. And so we pray for great wisdom in these days. And we pray also that we as your people, Father, would do as we're told and have wisdom and show love to others and consideration at this time. But Lord, we beseech you that in wrath you'd remember mercy. You know that our country has turned its back on God, passing homosexual marriage, passing the abortion of children, Father, right up to very late stages, even in our own country. And Father, many, many little children will be murdered. And so we pray for mercy upon us. God of mercy, we think of the words of Nehemiah when he cried out, I and my fathers have sinned and done this evil in thy sight. And Lord, we remember our church family today. We know there are many that are ill. You know them, Lord, by name. And we pray for those having tests. We pray for those having treatment. We pray for those with cancer, maybe, Lord. Pray for those that have had COVID. We pray for those, Lord, Father, who keep taking other types of infections. We pray for those with blood pressure. We remember those, Almighty God, with emotional and psychological problems because of all this. We pray for those that are lonely. We pray for those that are financially burdened because of all of this. And ask, Lord, for your peace to be upon them. For our older people that are now in homes, we pray for. And for their loved ones at home, we pray for. That God will be with them and keep them safe. We pray, Father, for Debbie. As she works from home, we pray for those in Madagascar as they translate the word of God into the language of the people, and for the hospital there. God, will you bless in that situation? We think of Madjet. We think of how he broke his shoulder, is it? And we pray that you would touch and heal him and make him a blessing among the Syrian people. Oh, God, our Father, we just pray for your peace upon wee Sammy in Uganda today, that your blessing and love would be upon him also. O loving Father, bless each and every one of us here. We ask that we may know your presence deeper in our lives every day, that our hearts would be filled with love and also with the peace of God. Jesus said, my peace I leave with you, my peace give I unto you. Let not your heart be troubled. Neither let it be afraid. Lord, let us have that perfect peace which casts out all fear at this time. Be with our man's family. Bless our dear minister as he preaches today. We ask that he may have liberty in the Spirit of God and that you'll speak to all of our hearts. And we ask all of these things, Lord, in your precious and worthy name. Amen.
Today, we have been remembering the fallen who gave so much in two world wars and in other conflicts. Now, one of the features of the world wars was that the British government, in every case, called for days of prayer for the nation. The situation was so urgent that prayer was seen as being absolutely crucial. Oh, if it was only the same today, if only our government would call us all to a time of national prayer. But you know, Psalm 67 would have been very appropriate to read at such a national day of prayer. Because in the first place here, we see in verses 1 and 2, the priority of prayer. David is calling to mind the Aaronic blessing of number 6, verses 24 to 26. We know it well, don't we? The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. This was the blessing that the Lord, through Moses, told Aaron and future high priests to pronounce upon the people of God. And so David, in effect here, is encouraging the people to pray scripture as they approach God. Prayer is to have a high priority in the life of God's people, and they're to ask God for blessing using the words with which he has promised to bless them. In effect, they're saying, look, Lord, you've promised to bring us blessing. So now we're asking you to do what you have promised. Now let's notice some things about this prayer in Psalm 67. First of all, it is a corporate prayer. David doesn't pray, Lord, be gracious to me. The prayer is, verse 1, may God be gracious to us. See, the assumption here is that God's people will pray for and with God's people. And we need to do the same, brothers and sisters. Praying together is absolutely vital. Corporate prayer matters. But in the second place, it's a prayer for God's grace. The people are to ask God to be gracious to us. That is, to be so loving and good as to give them that which they did not deserve and could not earn. In effect, they are to ask God for mercy. Their sin deserves his wrath, it deserves his judgment, but they're to pray for mercy instead. And that's the wonder of our God, dear people. He's always willing to give us what we don't deserve. We deserve this virus that's going on at the minute. We deserve the chaos that it's causing. We had sinned as individuals, as a nation, and as a world. But we need to come before our Lord and we need to pray and plead with God. Be gracious to us. Pour out your mercy upon us. We have to beg for forgiveness and for a new start. And you know what? God will give it to us. In the third place, it's a prayer for blessing. May God be gracious to us and bless us. Spurgeon says, when God blesses us, he enriches us indeed, for his blessings are gifts and deeds. His blessings are gifts and deeds. What gifts? The gifts of forgiveness, of salvation, of a relationship with him, the deeds of his goodness, his help, and his strength. Fourthly, it's a prayer for God's smile. May your face smile upon us. May your face shine upon us. That's what God's people need to pray. And to have the happy, smiling face of God look upon you is the greatest gift any man or woman or young person or child can ever, ever know. There is nothing better, because when God smiles on you, you can be absolutely sure that he's going to grant your requests. Think of it this way. If you approached Queen Elizabeth II to ask her to grant you some wonderful act of grace and favour, you could tell immediately whether you had any hope of getting it or not. As you approached her and saw that she was scowling at you, you would know that your petition was doomed. But if she was beaming brightly at you, you would be confident of a positive outcome. What would make the difference? Who you are. If you're a stranger to her, with no right to approach, then the scowl would greet your arrogance at bothering her, at daring to step out of line and to come near her when you weren't meant to. But if you're known to her, if you have an intimate relationship with her, she'll greet you with a broad smile. Now, do you get the point? When a believer approaches God in prayer, God smiles because he sees his own Son, Jesus Christ, in you. You're a child of God through faith in Christ, and the Father delights to welcome you and smiles on you. John MacArthur puts it this way: to have the glorious, happy face of God smiling on you is the greatest gift you can have. To know that as God looks on you, he is well pleased because you are in Jesus, there is no greater source of peace and power in life. Put it another way: when you know that God is for you, then you can freely plead with him in prayer, and you can ask for more grace and more blessing. But there's a final thing about this prayer. It's a prayer with evangelistic intent. The believers are not just to pray for their own wants and their own ends. They want grace and blessing for a greater reason. Look at verse 2. That your way may be known on earth, your saving power among all nations. They want to see others saved. It's that simple. They want grace, blessing, and help from God in their current circumstances so that they can reach others and let others in turn see the saving power of God. Let's think of it this way. Today, we're remembering the fallen, aren't we? Now, in both world wars, they didn't fight for narrow nationalistic reasons. At best, they were not trying to say that Britain is the greatest nation on earth. That wasn't the point. They were fighting to free others from tyranny and from dictatorship and from occupation so that those people could know the joy of liberty, true liberty. And when the government called for a national day of prayer and the people prayed for deliverance and victory, they were not doing so in order that Great Britain would be adored by all the people. They were doing so in order that the world would be free from tyranny. And of course, when freedom reigns, there is much more opportunity to spread the gospel than when dictators rule. And when we pray that the Lord would be gracious to us, that he would be blessing us and smiling upon us, and when we pray that he would take away this virus from amidst us, we must always do so longing that his actions will provide us with the best opportunities to spread the gospel and the great good news of Jesus Christ. So we've seen the priority of prayer. But there's a second thrust here in this psalm, and that's in verses 3 to 5, where we see the priority of worship. Let the peoples praise you, O God, says David. Let all the peoples praise you. Let the nations be glad and sing for joy, for you judge the peoples with equity and guide the nations upon earth. Let the peoples praise you, O God. Let all the peoples praise you. You see, humankind was made to worship God. That is why we exist upon this earth. The great Creator God desires that every person should bow before him and worship Jesus Christ as Lord. Not just one nation, not just one people group, but every single person who has ever lived. But why should all the peoples of the earth worship the Lord Jesus Christ? Worship the living God? Well, first of all, because God judges all fairly. You judge the peoples with equity, writes David. In other words, he uses exactly the same standard for all. No matter what color you are, what gender you have, what creed, all are judged on the basis of his perfect law and on the basis of his Son. But there's a second reason why everyone should worship the Lord God. Here it is. Because God guides the life of every nation. You guide the nations upon earth, we read there in verse 4. The truth is that God is in control of every single nation on the face of the earth. And he uses each one for his glory and the good of his church. Therefore, each nation has a responsibility to worship him and to worship him alone. And it doesn't matter whether they're a Hindu nation, a Muslim nation, a Buddhist nation, a Christian nation, or a secular nation. They ought to be turning away from their own narrow aims, their own traditions, and they ought to be coming to bow before the Lord Jesus Christ, through whom all of them were created, and through whom they are all kept in existence. You know, there's only one way to God. There's only one living and true God, and he's the Father of the Lord Jesus Christ, and you can only come to him through Jesus Christ, not through Allah or Buddha or any of the Hindu gods or any other way. One God, one means of salvation, by grace alone, through faith alone, in Christ alone. And the Lord is speaking loudly in these days, and the peoples of the world need to listen and recognize that he is guiding them in these days, and they need to turn to Christ while they may. But then there's one final thrust we need to see. In the third place, we see the promise of blessing in verses 6 and 7. The earth has yielded its increase. God, our God, shall bless us. God shall bless us. Let all the ends of the earth fear him. David is giving many, many thanks for the great number of blessings that he has experienced and his people have experienced. But he's doing more than that. He's looking forward to multitudinous blessing in the days to come. What kinds of blessing? Well, there's temporal blessing. For example, a good harvest. He says, the earth has yielded its increase. God, our God, shall bless us. God blesses us with the food that we eat. And he has promised that seed time and harvest will not cease while the earth remains. And he's given the rainbow as the sign of that promise. And therefore, we can thank him for what he's done in the past. And we can look forward with confidence to what he will do in the future. He pours out the temporal blessings of every day upon us, and we need to be grateful for them. And we need to keenly anticipate the new ones that are coming. And that's why it's so important to do something like thinking about the blessings that God has given you for the next 100 days. Every day for the next 100 days, take time to stop and write down one thing to give thanks for to God that day. One blessing that he has poured out. Count your blessings. Name them one by one, and you'll be amazed at what the Lord has done. David is thinking of temporal blessings, but he's also thinking of spiritual blessings, like people from the very ends of the earth being converted and coming to fear the Lord. You know, we ought to give thanks to our God, to our Jesus, for people we know who have been converted in the past. And we ought to be praying for people that we know by name who need to be converted now. And we ought to do so with the confidence that God is going to work right across this world, and he's going to work in our nation, and he's going to bring more people to know him. We ought to be thankful, and we ought to keenly anticipate future blessing. So let us, as we remember the past today, let us stop and give thanks, not just for the deliverances that we have received through the courage and bravery of people in the past, but we ought to stop and give thanks for all the blessings that God has poured upon us in years gone by. And we ought to look forward with immense confidence to what he's going to do in the future. So let us now pray together. O Lord God, we do remember the sacrifice of many in the past. We remember the blessings that you have brought us through that. But most of all, we remember the perfect sacrifice of the Lord Jesus Christ, the one who lived and died that we might be forgiven. We thank you for the many, many gifts that you give us in Jesus, and we look forward with great anticipation to many, many blessings in the days to come. Thank you, Lord, that you rule and you reign and you love us. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Thank you. now may the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen.